If you want to sidestep the hazing ritual that is coming up, then these videos will give you advice on how to do that. The hazing ritual is to prove your loyalty to the effort to bring about a new creation by forcing the Prime Creator to bring an end to creation. And of course, we are trying to develop a power that is no power in reality, the power of loss, the power of destruction. There is no such power in reality. We're trying to develop that in existence, which is why existence is such a pain for us. And there is this great loyalty test coming up, a hazing ritual to get into the club, so to speak. And 7 billion people on the planet right now, most of them are eager to prove their loyalty. They're here because the opportunity is here. Like if you want to get into a fraternity, sorority, you go, you know, rush week, you go there and you got to go to their house, whatever you call it, and you go there and then they put you through the hazing ritual. Whatever it is, the determine if you have the right stuff. So planet Earth right now is like a fraternity sorority house, and 7 billion people are here because they want to get into the club, and here is where the hazing ritual is going to take place. And the club is supposedly those who demonstrate extraordinary loyalty to this plan to threaten God with their destruction of reality, and then through that threat get God to change a little tiny bit of reality for us, just a little tiny bit, which means bring an end to endlessness, because the only way that endlessness can be changed is if it had some end to it. So we 7 billion people are here, most of them truly find it very, very important and significant that they're here, and are looking forward to the hazing rituals to come, believing that this will enable them to be fully included in the new creation, that they participated in this massive sacrificial loss, and that they therefore have gained status. It's like it's kind of like a way to gain tremendous status in the eyes of this plan and the so-called new reality with a new Prime Creator to gain. So it's a great opportunity for many. But for those who realize that God cannot change reality at all, reality can't be changed, there's no power to change it, and reality cannot be threatened by loss of any type, and we cannot create a new power of loss or destructivity, we're not able to do that, we have no ability to create any power at all, we know that the whole plan is futile and was futile from the very beginning, and so we realize that all of this is just a complete waste of time, nonsense, it won't get us anything. So we decide, you know, hey, let's sidestep this hazing ritual. Let's sit this one out. That's my perspective. Let's sit this one out. There are certain times, you know, where you have to say, wait a minute, let's just sit this one out. Okay, this is a little too heavy here. This enough is enough. I've been through enough hazing rituals in the past. I want to put an end to it. That's enough. Let's not go through this one. So there are those here on this planet that feel that way. How many, I don't know. And so for those who do feel that way, we have the ability to put it all in perspective. A great opportunity right now. We get to cut through all the nonsense from all levels. You know, there's been a lot of nonsense leading up to this hazing ritual. A lot of nonsense. Kind of like, you know, like the... Who is it? I don't know all the terminology of the fraternity and sorority, but like the head of the fraternity, you know, they're the ones that set up the hazing, maybe along with the other ones. And it's like we've had this planet has been visited by various mindsets that have helped set up this whole ritual, you know, and everybody's kind of saying, wow, that's great. And it's all set up, and we all seem like this is what we have to do. It's like super important. It's not important. It has zero importance. So we have to liberate ourselves from all of that. And it's easy to do, but you see, because existence is just one scheme, one little pathetic, useless, futile, silly scheme. That's all it is. It's just one little tiny ridiculous scheme. No matter how grandiose it may present itself as, it's just one little scheme. And so we just can reject it, just dismiss it, and laugh it away. Chuckle it. Give a chuckle, laugh it away. It's completely ludicrous. And yet we forgot to laugh it away. So everyone's taking it so serious. You know, this, hey, we've got to make the grade. We have to gain status. It's all important. And so you may go to someone and just explain very clearly, hey, there's a way to have this all pass you over. And there most certainly is. And just explain the stark simplicity of the entire situation of existence, which is easy to do. And they say, no, don't bother me, I'm busy. And you might ask them, you know, busy doing what? And they say, well, I'm chanting these mantras, I'm meditating, I'm following this guru, I'm following this teacher, I'm involved in all these activities, and I'm elevating the planet Earth, the vibrations of planet Earth, I'm helping save the world, I'm doing on and on and on and on and on. And they say, I got no time to listen to what you're saying, I just don't have any time to listen to it, I'm too busy, you know, anchoring myself here, so I make sure that I go through the hazing ritual, because most of us don't really want to, but we feel we must, like it's super important that we don't want to avoid it, because we feel we're going to be left behind, we'll have no place in the new reality at all, we'll be totally annihilated. No place at all. So we feel, well, we better at least go through this, you know, even though we don't want to. So we kind of keep ourselves anchored into this path, this direction, by doing all sorts of spirituality things, thinking that, okay, at least we're doing the right stuff here. Meanwhile, we're marching right into the oven. And so it's very tough, because people, there's this inner fear of exclusion. Inner fear of exclusion. And I may have to pause this for just one second. Which is causing everybody to cling to something which is not it, you know. And so one might ask, if it's so simple as is being said here, why haven't we heard it before? Because people are too intimidated. That's why. We've been too intimidated. We've intimidated ourselves. Our own desire to be prime creator has made us believe that we can do it. We can succeed. And then that terrifies us that we might be excluded. We might do something to exclude ourselves. And so the closer we get to this hazing ritual, the more juvenile everybody's acting in the world. You know, I look in and check in with the world, you know, usually every day. Not every day, but most every day I do, and just to see. And the juvenility of the world is off the charts right now. And you think, it can't get any worse, and every day it gets much worse. You really have like 2-year-olds running the world, and they're squabbling with each other. You know how easy it is for really juvenile mindset to get in fights over something. They seem to be able to get into squabbles, generate squabbles constantly, and they never can resolve them either. That is just, you know, it's pathetic. But that is how the world is right now, and it's becoming just going completely nuts. It's just one vast squabble among those who have no idea how to resolve a squabble at all. And that's a very, very, very bad situation, to say the very least. And so in trying to explain the simple truth, truth is extraordinarily simple. You run into a situation where people feel extremely worried they might get left behind, excluded from the new reality. And so they try to play it both ways. They try and pretend some sort of spirituality, as long as it doesn't offend the plan to be included in the new reality. They don't want to offend in any way. They don't want to say anything that they think might lead to their exclusion. All right. So in this world, typically you don't get the simple, clear teaching at all. And so when you hear it, you say, "Wow, that's the first time I ever heard that. How is that possible?" And so I have to explain, how is this possible? And it's possible from the dynamic that I've explained to you, that we believe that that reality is going to come to an end. We'll be able to force the prime creator to bring reality to an end, and that then we will create a new reality. We'll be the prime creators of this new reality, and there, and we will be able to include or exclude whatever we want. We'll set the rules. And that if we don't go along with this plan, and if we jump ship back to reality as it is now, that somehow we will have betrayed. We will be seen as traitors and betrayers, and unacceptable for the new creation. We will not, and so we will not be included in the new creation, meaning when the old creation passes on, we too will be passed on. We will be annihilated. We will be no more. We will not be carried over into the new creation. You see, so we try to threaten the prime creator by saying, "Prime creator, look, we're going to destroy all of reality if you don't change a little bit of it." And of course, since reality is endless, the only way to change it is to bring an end to it. And we say, if you do that as a token of goodwill to us, we will carry you over into the new creation. Okay, that's the deal. And so we are desperately afraid that we might do something so we're not carried over into the new creation. And that is why you hear teachers vacillating all over they're all over the place as far as their teachings go. And they contradict themselves with, you know, completely contradictory, and go to one side and then the other side, and you just say, whoa, you know, it all doesn't add up at all, because they're trying to please both. They're trying to give a nod to reality and the prime creator. At the same time, they're trying to give a nod to the idea of a new creation and a new prime creator, because they don't want to be excluded. And they haven't resolved this yet. They haven't resolved this issue. It's very tough to resolve it because the threat is so extreme. So people are afraid to look there. They don't look there. And this is my testimony in examining the spiritual history of this planet, is people are not willing to really look at the root of it. It seems too threatening. So you get a lot of spiritual teaching in this world that you realize it's contradict. It just doesn't add up at all. Doesn't add up at all. And then when you get something that's very direct, you try to then fit it in to some other spiritual teaching, or you try to say, well, where did this come from? It must have developed something. And you can't find it. Then you get kind of worried, like, uh-oh. It's because people are not willing to address this situation head on and completely, starkly in the open, and just point out exactly the situation, and of course be threatened with exclusion from the new reality, which I have been under that threat my entire life, and literally battling my whole life to try and get the courage to deliver this message under the fear that if I did, I would be excluded from the new reality. So that's a terrible, terrible fear, and at every step of the way the there's this temptation to quit and give a mixed message, you know, play it safe, try to please both. And of course Jesus said you can't serve two different masters, because you would be unfaithful to both of them, which is very true. And so you have to choose. But again, the plan to be prime creator plays it very cleverly, saying, well, you know, if you're just not too vocal about it, not too direct about it, you know, we will manage somehow to shoehorn you into the new reality. So every step of the way, it keeps trying to make deals. There's always this deal making situation going on, and it's a battle, because you think, wow, maybe it's not such a, you know, big deal to make a deal at this point, because, you know, it's brutal. The spiritual path is very brutal. It's very difficult. That's an understatement, because of this threat. This threat. Now, now will bringing this out in the open help others? I would assume so. Probably, yeah, definitely. If you look at it, at the very least, you know there's at least someone who's not afraid of being excluded from the new reality. Why? Because I know there won't be any. So it's all a bluff. So I'm not afraid to be excluded. So therefore, I'm able to speak up directly more and more and more. And even though you'll still have your doubts, at least you can say, And it'll take the edge, you know, off some of it. But I tell you, there is no magic pill for the trouble that you're in. There is none. And so I'm just trying to be very direct about this. I wish there was, but there isn't. Because the bluff is so extreme. It's so extreme. And, you know, the threat is so extreme that you'll be excluded from the new reality and therefore you'll be annihilated. It is such an extreme threat that it just, your mind, you know, your spirit has trouble facing it at all. And so it's very willing to settle for some deal. Very willing to settle for it. So you have all these so-called spiritual teachers who've settled for a deal. They said, okay, we'll make a deal. All right. And, we can get on TV, you know, get on a TV show and popularize it, and everybody goes, ah, great, you're not asking us to be excluded from the new reality. That's great. We can even build the new reality. Let's get busy on that, you know. Like we have to build paradise on earth. What could be more foolish than that? Nothing could be more foolish than that. But that's the example of what happens when you cut a deal. You know, you just say, wow, I can't take this anymore. I'm so depressed. I'm so stressed out. I just got to come up with some bargain here and let's end the troubles. In my case, I was super stubborn and not willing to make a deal. And even though the suffering was just completely unconscionable and off the charts, the fear, because I saw reality. And I said, wait a minute, you cannot change reality. You cannot destroy. It's not possible. So I knew there was something, some lie. You know, there's a big lie being told. But, you know, it's super hard to face it, because you're shaken in fear. We're scaring ourselves. God is not scaring us. We're scaring ourselves. And we're very good at that. Very, very good at that. Because literally we say, hey, we need to succeed, or else we're going to be excluded. We have to do this, or I'll be excluded from the new reality. In other words, we'll be annihilated. And we believe it. That's part of the belief system of what we've been familiar with. And so when you say, wait a minute, this belief system isn't right, you immediately feel, uh-oh, I'm going to be excluded from the new reality, because you can't. This is a taboo. You can't say that. We're all under this pressure. Everyone's under this pressure. That's what makes the whole situation extremely difficult. Anybody can listen to words. Any kind. kind of spiritual teaching and process it conceptually. You know, anybody can do that. But to really take a look and see is a whole different thing. See for yourself. In other words, internalize it and see for yourself. Very few are willing to do that. Simply, they feel totally threatened with annihilation if they do that. And there's the problem. And those who do attempt this will find themselves under... I found myself under just ridiculous kinds of stress, inner stress and conflict and thinking, hey, you know, why am I doing this? Why don't I just cut a deal? You know, this is stupid. Why? And it's horrible. So there is no shortcut to it, really. You really have to see it for yourself. Doesn't matter if somebody else sees it, because you can still say, well, I haven't seen it, so I'm not going to be excluded from reality. The fear is, if you see it and you know it, that is what's going to exclude you from the new reality. That's the fear. So we don't look. We don't look. That is the entire problem. Because if you looked at what the problem really is, you would see how simple it is and how ridiculous it is. And then you would be free. Oh, you know, your fear would evaporate. Super easy, except we simply don't look at what the problem is. We don't look at it. We look everywhere but there. Because, again, we feel if we look, we're risking being excluded from the so-called new reality. And so you have people who can amass incredible amounts of spiritual knowledge and concepts, and they seem like, you know, they seem like unbelievably bright and intelligent, etc., etc. But they haven't looked. So they're clueless about what the problem really is. They don't know at all. And that's what I come across. And teachers, I look at them, I say, okay, but where's the beef? Okay, explain the simplicity of the whole situation. You never hear it. You never hear it because they haven't looked there. So it's like everyone is compensating for not looking and seeing what the problem really is. So in compensating, they make incredible, grandiose compensations. You know, they build these sandcastles, these incredible sandcastles of compensation to pretend like they know, but inwardly they know they didn't really look, and so they don't really know. So they have to kind of hide this by grandiose, you know, titles. You know, they give themselves all sorts of grandiose titles and more titles and more robes and more accoutrement, you know, and grand theater. And they build themselves up bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And all the while, they don't really know what the problem is at all because they haven't looked. They haven't looked. Too afraid to look. They feel it's too risky. They feel it's better to build up this vast charade, spiritual charade, than to simply look. Because looking might be too much, it's too risky, it might be too much trouble for them, you know, all this stuff. So you have a lot of, you know, spiritual braggarts in the world who are clueless, and yet they're able to dissemble to such an extent that they seem like, you know, how could they not? They know everything else, so how could they not know it all? That's kind of thing. You know, we kind of make that foolish conclusion, like just because somebody, you know, seems to know it all spiritually, that doesn't necessarily mean they know the one thing that has to be known. It may be a compensation for not knowing the one thing. Jesus said, sell all your jewelry and go into the market and buy that one pearl of great price. That's what he's talking about. Forget about all this compensatory spiritual stuff and just take a look at the simple problem we have, the scheme. How can we be saved unless we admit that we've been up to this scheme? It's just a scheme. We've been scheming. How can we be saved? How can we even say that we can be saved? It's nuts if we don't look and admit into this scheme and give up the scheme. Just simply say, ah, I see that all this is all just a one little crazy scheme. It'll never work. There will never be another reality. There's no fear of exclusion. All I need to do then is abide in the reality that is. But we have to see that we've been engaged in this scheme. We have to see it. We have to look at it and see it. Once we see it, we say, ah, it's nothing. Easy. Piece of cake. Reality's not threatened by any loss. Piece of cake. But if we don't look there, oh my gosh. What a nightmare. What a nightmare. And people build up these grandiose compensations, and they drag a whole, you know, what do they call it? A sangha in with them, a whole big following of those in with them to support, you know, their compensation. And of course, everybody's eager to do that because they don't want to look either. So it's kind of like someone will come here, you know, big pompous spiritual bully saying, I got all the answers. And people will say, oh, really? But they're really saying, oh, I mean, you got him without really looking there? And they say, yeah, you don't need to look there. Don't worry. I got all the answers. Just follow me and you'll be fine. So it's a kind of a collective delusion, right? The big spiritual leader and all those the followers is a mutual dependency, because neither one side of wants to look where they need to look, and they all want to reinforce the belief that they don't have to look. They can build up enough spiritual gravitas, you know, through whatever they're doing, that they don't ever have to look there. And then of course the wheels fall off eventually, and all sorts of problems arise. Because again, they feel that the threat is too severe, that it's not worth the risk. What they're really saying is they're too lazy to spend the time to really look at it carefully. Because it does take time. It does take time. It's like diffusing a bomb, and you're spending all this time diffusing it. And when you get to the heart of it, you get to the final part that's supposed to contain, you know, the element, you know, the terrible element. And you look at that, and you know, just like nothing there. And you think, oh my gosh, there never was any danger ever. So theoretically, you can just, you know, be done with it right now. But practically, we have so believed, we've used the power of our mind in the service of belief and faith and imagination to such an extent to try and build up a power that we believe we will one day be able to accomplish, that we believe we can force God to bring an end to reality. And that automatically then brings in this terror of exclusion. Automatically. That is the real fear, is terror of exclusion from the new reality. And so we're in this dilemma. We really are. So don't be judging yourself too harshly, like, why can't I finish? Why can't I, you know? Because this dilemma is, you're on the horns of a dilemma, very severe dilemma, and no matter what anybody says, you know, it's not so practically, you cannot just, okay, just theoretically can, practically, it doesn't work out that way, because you say, well, wait a minute, you know, we have so much familiarity with what we've been working on. And we're so identified with it, and we're so completely, for so long, have believed that we are going to be the new prime creators of a new reality. And this is like a fait accompli. You see, in order to believe in this whole effort in the first place, that it can ever, we can even entertain it at all, we have to believe it is a fait accompli, and it is a done deal, it's going to happen. We have to believe that. So we have this belief that is a fait accompli, which then triggers this fear of exclusion. And then we start, in our mind, we start saying, well, wait a minute, what can I realize and what can I not realize? Where can I look and where can I not look? And we go look for teachers who will tell us, you know, where we can look and where we should not look. Most of the time, people go to spiritual teachers for that purpose. They go to them saying, well, I'm so scared I'm going to be excluded, you know, from the new reality. Can you please help me grow into that new reality? Can you help me do the right thing? I tell you, 99% of every all spirituality on this planet is exactly that. Is people looking for teachers who can help them grow, evolve, progress, be on the right path to be included in the new reality. Almost all of it is just that. And you know, if you can see that, I mean, intuitively, people can recognize that. It starts dawning. You know, you say, yeah, I sort of see that, but it's kind of scary to see it. It's pretty threatening to see it. Because we don't have to grow or evolve or do or progress or do or worry about exclusion at all, about the true reality that will always be. We're already perfectly included in it, endlessly. We can never be excluded. Okay, we don't need to progress till we're already perfectly, flawlessly in it. We don't need to learn anything. Our functionality is already set for us. We're perfectly functional. So all this talk about progressing, evolving, raising our vibrations, becoming more spiritual, all these things, and the teachers who help guide us along these ways, it's really designed to get us into, quote-unquote, the new reality, and help us avoid doing anything which might exclude us from it. See? That's what it is. So, of course, if you want to present yourself as an expert on that, you know, the whole world will follow you, for sure. And if you just simply tell the unadorned, clear truth by looking at what the problem really is, very few are going to pay attention to you, very few, because they feel the threat is too severe. Because they feel that someday someone will say, oh, you listen to that person, and that person didn't believe that we could succeed, and you didn't believe either, so you're going to be excluded. You know, it's like, oh my God, you know, it's so threatening. Some people feel like such misfits, you know, that they say, what the heck, you know, I'm already excluded here in this world, so I might as well just go for it. You know, those are the fortunate ones. Those are the fortunate ones that just, they say, well, what do I got to lose? I got nothing to lose. I've already lost everything. I already feel excluded. So why not take a look, you know? And then they look and they say, hey, wait a minute. I'm not excluded from reality. And there isn't going to be any new reality. Wow, I hit the jackpot, you know? So it's the ones who have the courage and the grace to simply look in the right place. They hit the jackpot. They realize, hey, I'm already in reality. The only reality there is, I can't be excluded from it. And how great is that? Fantastic. I don't have to keep trying to build up some power to threaten this reality, because I know that's a waste of time. So there is for those fortunate ones, there is a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow by looking at what the problem really is. And the whole thing, you realize, just resolves easily. But for the rest, oh my gosh, you know, what a trail of tears. Because the constant threat of exclusion, it's never spoken of in this world, is it? I've never come across anybody that is saying these things, really. The threat of exclusion from a new reality, because it is so, it's taboo to even talk about it. Because we're so scared of it, we don't even want to bring the issue up in fear that just by bringing it up, somehow we might get excluded. Because we're all pretending like, oh, of course I won't be excluded, so why do I even need to bring the issue up? You know, it's that kind of fear. We're so afraid that we don't even want to bring it up because we want to pretend like, I'm not worried, you know. I'm going to make it. I'm going to make it for sure. So there you go. That's the attitude of the world. How can we make it? How can we avoid, you know, our own wrath? How can we keep our loyalty going? How can we prove our loyalty? We're so solicitous to prove our loyalty. We're so eager to do it, you know. How can we do it? How can we do it? We want to go find some teacher. How can we prove our loyalty? And the teachers will say, okay, we'll tell you how to do it. You know, you just need to, you know, live this way and see things this way and this and this and that. And some of them will throw out some great sounding stuff. And on the other hand, they'll throw out the other stuff too. You know, it's kind of like toss it out to you, so it's kind of like a mixed salad. So you can kind of feel like you're on the cutting edge, even though you're playing it safe. You know, play it safe. And so this is just grand foolishness, but it is the situation. Of course, when you come into this world, I came into this world, and what happened was it was more difficult than I expected. So I kind of felt sorry for myself. You know, I just said, wow, is this, I don't know, this is, maybe it's just too much, too difficult. You know, I wasn't able to overcome this incredible intransigence here. Because to me it seems so easy, but I didn't quite see clearly enough, and therefore I sort of lapsed into, you know, just hoping that you know, the world would take pity on me or something, which it never did. And it's super difficult to come into this world and simply continue to radiate assurance and not be bothered by complete intransigence of the world. I mean, it's super difficult. Because again, everybody will come to you, and they don't really, they want you to tell them where to look other than where the problem is, and that's all they want. That's all they want. You know, and if you say, well, no, just look right at the problem, they go, ah, you know, ha, forget it. You know, you crazy. You know, I'm gonna. They say, well, we're gonna go some other direction there, and the world gets what it wants. It gets all these teachers who put on a good song and dance, put on a big show, you know, but they're all hat and no cattle. You know, that's the truth. And some of them have really big hats, really big hats. Yeah. I mean, you talk about they got the hats with the whole city on the hat, you know. Yeah. They wear the city hat, and, but no cattle. No cattle there. You know, no. Having no looking directly at what the situation really is. So, in other words, they haven't given up the scheme. They're still scheming. They still believe, you know. But they're going to be the new prime creator. They're going to be the ones that set the new rules. They're going to be the ones who decide who gets in and who doesn't. You know, we love that in this world, don't we? Deciding who gets in and who doesn't. Who gets to stay on the island, who doesn't. Who gets into this university? Who doesn't? Who gets this job? Who doesn't? We're all so keen on status, and who makes it, and who doesn't make it. You know, we're obsessed with that, totally obsessed. Where the truth is that we're already full, perfect members of reality, in perfect standing with all rights and privileges. We're already pre-qualified for reality. In fact, we are already members of reality. We can never be excluded from reality. Never. No possibility of it. None. Even when we believe that we can destroy reality and create a new one, we're still not excluded from it. Not at all. Because we can't do it. So there's no harm, no foul. We can't harm reality. Reality can't be harmed. So how can anybody, on what basis can anyone be excluded from reality? Reality can't be harmed, can't be changed in any way. So, what basis could there possibly be to be excluded from reality? There's no basis. Zero. And so we already have that, you know. And yet, we know, even if we know we have this, you know, we say, yeah, okay, but we're still worried, like, what happens if we do develop this power of destructivity, and therefore we are able to force God to bring an end to reality, and we do become the new creators of a new reality. What then? You know, then we'll be excluded, you know. So even though we, you know, we hear this talk about, yeah, we're all one, we're still, you know, in reality and all this stuff, we still, that doesn't solve it for us. Doesn't solve it for us. Doesn't solve it for us. And so we settle for something less. We settle for something less. Really do. Really do. That's what I see the teachers, the gurus of the world, they're settling for something less. Because there still is that little inner, you know, feeling like I better not go all in because I may be left all out. And so they kind of hedge their bets. And so spiritual path, again, the real path is nerve-wracking, really. It's nerve-wracking because of this inner dynamic that we've been talking about here. So I'm trying to say, how can it be made a little easier, you know? And there are ways it can be made easier. It was made easier for me. As tough as it was made easier by help that I got. I got A Course in Miracles helped me. Ananda Mahima helped me. Ramana Maharshi helped me. Because they were all in, you see. Ananda Mahima, all in. No doubt. She was absolutely no doubt that our scheme would never succeed. She knew it would never succeed, and therefore was all in with reality, simply abiding in reality, the bliss of reality. No doubt, but zero doubt. So I saw that and I say, wow, that's possible. You know, here's at least someone who's all in and is not the slightest bit concerned about all our scheme. You know, I could tell, not concerned about our scheme. And so that left a profound impression upon me, profound. And then, of course, in Miracles kind of explained the whole situation, the scheme, basically gradually laid bare the whole scheme, gently laid it bare, at least gave me the tools, and then I could work on it and had enough confidence to gradually work on it and boil it all down to, you see, the scheme in its bare bones, you know, the bare bones of the scheme. And then when you see that, you realize the threat that you've been under this whole time. When you're on the spiritual path, you're under this threat. You're under this threat. And you can feel it. And you have this free-floating anxiety. Okay? I always had this free-floating anxiety. You know? And I went to all sorts of therapy. Everything. And nobody had a clue, you know, what it is. Nobody knew. I didn't even know, you know. It was too buried. But it was this feeling of dread, existential dread, severe threat, feeling of severe threat. And, you know, couldn't find any plausible explanation for it whatsoever. But now I know what it was all this time. It was just completely free floating, constantly there, you know, basically telling me, shut it down, shut the path down, you're getting too close, you're getting too close. What happens is when you start getting really close to looking where you need to look and seeing the problem as it is, all these warning bells start going off. We booby-trapped the whole thing, you know, like that, and you have all these sirens, and it scares the heck out of you. Those are like warnings to stay away, stay away, stay away. You know, you're in dangerous territory. Turn around. You literally have all this alarm bells going off, and that you experience that as severe anxiety, crippling anxiety, terrified. You say, oh my gosh, you know, I'm in a danger zone. So there's nothing I could do except just continue on, and just suffer this anxiety. Couldn't find any treatment, any cure, nothing anyone could do for it. And now I see what it was, you see. But I was determined to continue on until I found out the answer, because I said, I get beat up this bad. I want to know why I got beat up so bad, right? So if you're suffering like that, you know, think about that and say, hey, I need to pursue this to the end. So I want to find out, why was I beaten up so bad? And you can get there, and you can see, it was this threat, this ultimate existential threat. I'm going to be excluded from the new reality. That was the threat. That was the anxiety. And of course, I never had a single therapist or read a book or anything that ever brought this up or whatsoever. It was never even remotely touched upon. Now, A Course in Miracles pulled away enough stuff, you know, thinned it out enough so I could pursue it. But I don't believe that A Course in Miracles directly says this in this such stark terms. It intimates it. It touches upon it. It kind of, it thins it out, thins it out. So it's very helpful. But it's not like, the anxiety disappeared when I studied A Course in Miracles for 15 years, the book, and it's been, 34 years of consideration of it. It didn't cure the anxiety. The anxiety was still there. It started lessening it a little bit. A little bit less, a little bit less, a little bit less. And right now, it's lessening even more rapidly. I'm almost like able to just push it all away. It's getting to that point. Because I've finally seen what the threat was all along, what the fear was. Unfounded fear, unfounded. And yet, our own belief in our own capability made it seem like it was legitimate, something we should be legitimately threatened to worry about. So no matter what I did, I could not dispel it up until seeing, just seeing what the threat really was and just looking directly at it. Then you say, that's what it was. Now I see. It's unfounded. Has no true foundation. Has no foundation in reality whatsoever. Nothing to worry about. And so I believe I'll be able to push that all away at some point. I know I will be able to. But the residue is, the echoes are still with me of a terrible time of struggling with this and not being able to get the help that I really needed in a large amount. I got enough. But boy, there are not many teachers or teachings out there in the world that can really help with this. If you're serious about looking at the problem directly, there's not much help out there. But fortunately, there is enough to enable you to succeed, along with your own determination. And the more you get beat up, for me, the more I got beat up, the more determined I was to succeed. I said, hey, there's something beating the living tar out of me, this isn't right. And basically, I was just a punching bag for fear, and not able to do anything about it. Every day, I just got completely bullied by this fear, and I just sat there and had to take it. Couldn't do anything about it because I said, I don't know where this is coming from. And then you just basically keep trying. And of course, there's all sorts of gurus out there who are saying, hey, you got some problem? Come worship me. Come follow me. And I'd always look at them and say, do you really have the answer? And I'd see, I don't think they really have the answer for me. And they didn't. But there's plenty of teachers out there who will proclaim that they do have the answer. But they don't. They haven't gone all in. So, and Jesus says something about, those who are suffering are really blessed, because, in other words, those who are trying to look directly what the problem really is, that they have this inner suffering, this torment. It's called the dark night of the soul. As you go through this process, this period, where you don't know what the threat is, you can't identify it. You cannot identify it. You don't know where it's coming from. No matter where you look, you can't find it. It's bizarre. It's frustrating. I read so many books that by experts supposed to know, how to cure anxiety and cure problems. None of them helped at all. They didn't have a clue. Once you have that determination to really see the truth, to know for sure, that's when you get hit with this free-floating anxiety. It's terrible. You just feel like you're in the clutches, like you're in the middle of an ocean, and you have this little, raft, or you're holding onto a log that's floating, and the waves are just, a storm is just hitting you. every possible way, and you get knocked under. Every waves are just breaking over you and pushing you under, and you look out, and all you see is this vast ocean. There's no land anywhere, and you're continually getting smashed by these waves, and you're barely hanging onto the log, you know, and you just don't, you don't have any hope. You know, you have no idea, you know, how to get to land, how to get out of the storm. You really don't. And you do get some help. Like, I came across some help, and you cling to that help. You know, you cling, you say, okay, at least I've got this log I can cling to. But still, the waves are just smashing you. And you just have to be very determined. You know, the more the ocean beats you up, for me, the more determined I got. I said, hey, you know, this is over the top. You know, this is over the top. You know, I don't appreciate this, what's going on. And it's really vicious. And I'm going to find out what the cause of it is, because I'm going to put an end to this at some point. You know, so I was willing to then keep suffering because I was determined to, you know, end all suffering. It's that kind of situation, because it just say, hey, this isn't good. And it wasn't good at all. So we've got this situation now. I'm just adjusting the light a little bit, because the light is changing, as it always does in this world, right? We've got a good situation now, really, in that, having seen this, you know, it's possible that benefits will accrue. It's possible. I don't know. I don't know how things are going to work, really. I don't know. How can I lighten this up like that? But it seems like I'm able to push this out, which is good. Just pushing out this, just saying this to the world is a huge thing. Because, of course, you can always think you can make a deal. Let's say you discover this and you knew the truth, and yet you would feel like the mind would come to you and say, okay, but we don't want you to tell anybody. I'll tell you what, the mind will make a deal and say, you keep it to yourself and you'll still be included in the new reality. But if you tell anybody about it, you're going to be excluded. So even then, it tries to threaten you. We threaten ourselves, saying, don't tell anybody. So by putting this out on the World Wide Web, where anybody in the world can access it, free to access it, I don't have any control over who accesses it. You know, basically, I've shared it with the entire world, theoretically, in theory, I have. It's up to them if they want to, you know, access it or not. But from my standpoint, it's already, you know, been done. Then that takes that threat away too. Like, you know, hey, it's a further step in calling the bluff of our own self-intimidation, self-threatening. We're threatening ourselves. We're threatening to exclude ourselves from the new reality. Of course, since we're all one, if we excluded ourselves from the new reality, we would exclude everyone, and there wouldn't be any new reality in the first place. So it's all, you know, a dead end, really. If you pursue it, see it through the eyes of reason, it's ridiculous. You have to believe that we're all fragments, and we can include some but not others. That's just why we identify with bodies, you know, because we seem to be separate and excluded and fragmented, and the idea is that some will be included and some will be excluded. That kind of thing seems possible, but really in spirit is one, and you cannot, the idea of excluding part of it, there is no part of it. You'd either exclude all of it or none of it. So the whole thing is ridiculous, and yet we don't see that. We don't see it, too threatened to look at it. So the ability to share this here means that I'm already pushing, you know, the fear away, and I believe that this will continue. We'll see. You never know. But I have some confidence and belief that this is very possible, Just a matter of continuing to work hard at it. And do the right thing, and this probably has some benefit. Again, it's not a magical benefit. It's not a magical benefit, because the power of your own, the power of our mind is so strong that it can generate such strong belief and familiarity, etc., that we just don't trust it. You know, we tend to trust the belief that we're going to succeed. You know, it's hard for us to realize we cannot succeed at this scheme that we've been working on. So again, we may say, well, he's just crazy. He's going to be excluded. He just doesn't care for some reason. You know, he doesn't mind. No, I would definitely mind. You know, of course I don't want to be excluded. But I know that there isn't going to be any new reality. So it's a non-issue. But still the doubt will be there. The doubt will be there. Saying, oh, he doesn't care for some reason. Now, of course, that the ego will say that. That we will tell ourselves this, advance that type of narrative. And you'll still be in doubt and fear, you know. It's not so easy to overcome this dilemma. It's not so easy, which is why I'm such a big advocate of a culture of support and an advocate of a civilization which enables you to carefully defuse this non-existent device, you know, this threat, non-existent threat. You really do have to carefully go through it and diffuse it and spend time looking at it in order to really do it. And you can't be under tremendous pressure to be some super person in existence and do all this stuff, you know, and also defuse this non-threatening device and see that there's nothing there, no threat there, no real threat at all. So I'm an advocate of a culture, a civilization, a situation which enables those who live there to do this work, this difficult work. It's difficult. And at present, we don't have that situation. We're not blessed with that situation. And how that situation can arise, we need to continue to pursue that narrative. It's important, because as I look at the world, I don't see success here. I don't see it happening. It's not happening. It hasn't happened in my lifetime. And looking back in the past, it hasn't happened either. Very limited success here. The world is too much with us. The drive to, for one, build up this power of destructivity is all important. That's what existence is. So we're caught up in this constant loss, constantly going. This loss is constantly building up here. And then we're also pre-planning we're working hard to get into the so-called new reality. So we're trying to build up all sorts of attitudes and lifestyle that we think will get us included. So we're obsessed with our lifestyle of trying to develop, you know, a lifestyle that will get us in. So you mix those two things together, just the ordinary constant attrition of loss in existence, and then with the desperate striving to build up some sort of lifestyle that will enable you to gain entrance to the putative new reality. Those two factors just consume one's life, and you end up with, you know, no success. And that's what I see, you know. So it's hard to come into this world of no success and yet still radiate the fact that none of that really matters at all. That's very difficult. Because truly the Prime Creator is not judging us for our lack of success. And reality is not affected by it in any way. So if you simply radiate that reality is unaffected by our inability to realize our scheme, you know, that's really something. Difficult. That's the ultimate. That's what needs to be done. And we can do it. We can do that. And by doing that, that somehow brings a layer of assurance to us that we say, wait a minute, even though we've been failing, you know, it's something failing, it's okay. We can take the time. it kind of enables us to feel, wait a minute, I'm not really under the gun. Let me take the time to do it. I guess the greatest gift I got was simply, I felt like taking the time to do it was okay, because I spent my whole life at it, and I felt like, you know what, this is the right thing to do, because basically that's what you need to do. And if you don't feel that it's right to spend your life at this, you won't do it. You won't spend your life, and you're going to settle for some teacher who's going to try and school you as to how can you get into the new reality. Ultimately, that's what's going to happen. So it's super important to feel that it's okay to spend your time being very focused on this situation and trying to get past this threat. You know, easing your way past this threat. It can take a long time. It can also maybe take shorter time for some. Everyone's a little different, but it generally, the way the situation is, the bind, the dilemma is such that it's so severe that generally it can take quite a bit of time to finally ease your way past it. So you need a situation that where it's okay to do that, where it's okay, where you don't feel under the gun, you know, so much. And you know, it's a blessing to come across such a situation. My situation, I was worried about. I say, hey, I'm falling behind. And I was always told, don't worry. You're going to make it. Don't worry. The world is coming to trouble anyway. So don't fret that you don't know anything. I have no future. Don't worry about it. It's okay. So I kept being reassured. So that way I just, you know, kept working at it. But if you don't have that reassurance, it becomes too scary. Because you say, well, I spent my whole life at this. I still haven't succeeded. And I have nothing. I have no future. I haven't planned for a future whatsoever. I literally have not planned at all for any future. I never even gave it a thought. Other than I'm kind of scared, like, whoa, this is kind of risky. But I haven't given a thought to the future. What am I going to do? How am I going to survive? Anything. I don't have a clue. Don't have a clue. So that's kind of risky. If you have a culture, society that enables people to be spiritual renunciates, in other words, spend all their time working on this, getting past this threat, this false threat, they don't have to worry about their future. It's taken care of. You know, there's a whole, you know, religious systems, various systems have been set up to take care of renunciates. And if you don't have that, it becomes extremely difficult, you know, very frightening. But, you know, renunciates in various traditions have no money. They have no possessions of their own, you see? So how can they secure their future? They rely upon the compassion. And this way the system is set up is there is, you know, they're able to be taken care of and provided for in their old age. Roof over their head and some food and some medical care. So they don't have this feeling that they need to be worried about their future. They can go all focused, all in on focusing on getting past this threat. And this is, you know, going the way, vanishing, becoming extinct on this planet, as we kind of become so focused on something opposite of that we feel like, oh, they're getting a free ride, you know. And of course the system is abused. A lot of people get into it simply to get a free ride, yeah. But you can't throw out the baby with the bathwater. The situation, the dilemma we're in is so severe. You know, there isn't any way to just simply teach it, like in a classroom, and for a student to say, oh, okay, I get it. Conceptually, of course, you can get it. That doesn't remove the fear of the threat, because we fear our own judgment. We fear we're going to be judged for even considering this. And we feel our judgment is extremely harsh, and ultimately is. It's entirely harsh, because there isn't going to be any new reality. And we hide this fact by just saying there is, but we're just spending all this time. We need to judge to find out who's worthy of it. We disguise the impossibility of it by believing that it's just we have to set higher and higher and higher standards. So we put ourselves under the gun constantly, try to become more and more and more and more qualified for it. More and more severe, more and more severe, until we're saying, well, there's only a few that are going to make it, the rest of you. And then we say, well, if those few make it, maybe you could be in prohibition, and they will, at some point, you might be able to make it. You know, we just play games with this. But the real path is really intense. You know, it is intense. I picked my first habanero, homegrown habanero pepper, yesterday, and I try to like slice it up in pieces, and I tried a little piece, you know. And oh my God, it was like fire. I spit it out. I said, holy cow, that is unbelievably hot. I didn't realize anything could be that hot. And so I said, wow, I can't take it direct. It's too hot. I mean, I can't just, you know, eat it. What I did was I mixed it in with a bowl of salsa. I chopped it up real fine, and then I mixed it in with this bowl of salsa. And then I, you know, used dip chips in that and ate it. And it was still searingly hot, but I could take it. I could take it. And this afternoon I finished it off, and it was easy for me. So the fear of the threat is of exclusion is so severe that we can't just directly eat that habanero pepper boom like that. You know, we need to mix it in with some other salsa and not make it quite so hot. In other words, take time. Theoretically, of course, I could have eaten that habanero down, but I'm telling you, it would have absolutely freaked out my stomach and insides, and I would have been in bad shape, really bad shape. I'm not stupid. I spit it out. And it's like that. We think, oh, we can just, you know, see what the problem is, and boom, free. We're free. But if we try to do it that way, the threat arises. Severely. I told you once in one video, I lay on the ground. I heard Ramana Maharshi one day just lay on the ground when he was about 16 and said, okay, I'm going to die. Let me just die consciously here and see what's after death. And he just put himself into like rigor mortis, as it were, and like he was a corpse, and said, okay, my body's dead, and now what? And so I tried the same thing. I tried to say, okay, I'm going to now drop all falsity and get back to my complete assurance that reality is the only reality there is, and I'm just going to do it right now. So I lay on the floor, and what I found out was this extreme dread suddenly came roaring up, and like a vast tsunami, and it struck me so hard. I said, "Oh my gosh, what is that? Where did that come from? My God!" And so at that point, I realized, holy cow, I cannot just do it directly like that. I'm going to have to spend some time at this, okay? I'm going to have to mix that fear in, you know, with a gradualness. I need to kind of go at it a little gradually, more gradually. I can't go at it directly. This is incredible. I was shocked. I thought for sure I'd be able to do it. But what had happened is that the demands of the world is so, has such intense belief in this threat, and that they must avoid it all costs, must avoid looking at what the problem really is. It is so all pervasive here that it had gotten into me. That's why I was so surprised. Where did this come from? I never could have believed that there was anything like this, really. The fear was overwhelming. It was a massive tsunami of fear that just kept coming and coming and coming. It was unbelievable. And I said, whoa, where did that come from? You know, how did that build up? You know, amazing, shocking. So again, we can attempt to do it directly, but chances are that it's not going to work for us. Very rarely. I mean, theoretically, it's possible. Maybe on rare occasion, someone can simply, see it, and that's it, and just go right through it. And tsunami comes, and they just say, no, that's not coming from me. It's coming from the world, and I know that it's all based on a bluff that'll never happen. And so the tsunami goes right past them, right through them, and they don't even react to it or feel it. You know, that is possible. But for most of us, we end up having to gradually go through diminishing this sense of threat and trying to clarify. Most of us end up doing that. So we really have to have a situation set up that's helpful for that. And right now it's not so helpful, but we have to make the best with what we have, which is what I did. You know, I didn't have ideal circumstances, really. Just living in this world right now is not an ideal circumstance at all for any of us. It's terrible. It is really shocking to pay attention to the world right now. It's shocking. Holy cow. You talk about people who feel threatened. Holy cow. I mean, the world is full of people who are absolutely terrified that they may not be included in the new reality, and they're desperate to be included. They'll do anything. They'll demonize they'll do whatever they feel is needed, and they're fanatics. The world is really in a fanatical condition right now. Everyone is trying desperately to find out who's got the answers that I need to follow to get into the new reality that we assume is coming after this huge loss sacrifice that is coming up. This massive hazing ritual of destructivity and brutality and pain and suffering, which will somehow prove our loyalty and also prove to God that this power really does exist. Power of destructivity really does exist, and therefore can wipe out reality, and therefore God will have to make the deal, and we'll then be prime creators of a new reality. We feel it's a new creation. We feel it's super close, and so we're frantic to avoid looking at what the problem really is, and we're frantic to find out how to get oriented towards this new reality. And that's why you have everybody is acting like not, you know, fanatics, crazy. The world is just in a crazy condition right now. Trying to act the way they think they're supposed to be acting, so they won't be excluded from the new reality that they feel is a fait accompli very soon, because they know that this sacrificial scenario, this hazing ritual, is coming, and it's going to be brutal, and they feel that will prove their loyalty, and will also prove to the prime creator that there is this power of destructivity, and that we totally believe in it. we ourselves have been subjected to it, so we know it must be true, and we really believe this is going to come true super soon, very soon, as soon as we, you know, man, it's so close, people can almost taste it. And so they're frantic to make last minute preparations to make a smooth transition into what they believe will be a new reality. And so, you know, if you're not making all those frantic preparations, you may think, wow, I'm really out of it, you know. But you're actually making the right preparations to abide in the one reality that is and will always be. You're making preparations to have this whole crazy scenario pass you by and end up in the ideal circumstances. You're making preparations for that. But as far as waving a magical wand, you're like, oh, we had our DNA changed and now everything's fine. You know, how does that get rid of this threat dynamic that we're concerned about? How does it deal with that at all? It doesn't address it at all. The only way to address it ultimately is to look exactly at it, at what the problem really is, and see what we've our scheme, and see them and realize that it can never work, because we take a peek at reality and know, it's endless. There's no end to it. And knowing that our scheme to try and change a little bit of it is really the scheme to end, bring an end to it. And Prime Creator cannot bring an end to endlessness. The Prime Creator is endlessness. How can endlessness bring an end to endlessness? It's not possible. It's not possible. Endlessness is what reality is. That's what it is. It doesn't have an end. No power to bring an end to it. It has no power. Endlessness doesn't have any power to bring itself to an end. And we can never develop such a power, because we are also one with endlessness. There's no ability to develop such a power. So we're just simply aligning with this truth. Okay? And you see other people, you know, I look at the world and say, wow, it's like an insane asylum right now. Really? And it's kind of interesting, I mean, because looking at an insane asylum is kind of interesting. It's like, what in the world are these people? You never know what they'll do next. You never know. Somebody's just going to, do crazy. Every day there's something totally bizarre happening, and people are going off their rockers, and tempest in teapots, and everybody's just blowing their stacks and getting crazier and crazier. And it's kind of interesting. It's like, wow, what a farce. What a farce it is. You're looking at this farce. You have no idea what's going to happen next. So from one standpoint, it is a little bit interesting, but not really that interesting, So you can acknowledge, sure, it's a little bit interesting, but not all compelling. No, it's not all compelling. You can walk away from it. For instance, the reason, a lot of reasons why I advise don't watch the Olympics. But if you can put it in a nutshell, you need to prove to yourself that you can walk away from this insane asylum. You can just have it pass you by. It's not that compelling. And you're not going to really suffer. For instance, I didn't watch a second of the Olympics, not even one second of it. Okay? And I never felt the slightest deprivation whatsoever. And to this moment, I don't feel like I missed anything really important. I don't feel any deprivation. Just the opposite. I felt I used my time in a much, much better way. So, again, proving to yourself. You prove to yourself, hey, that's okay. Having this insanity bypass me is not going to cause a problem. But you have to prove it to yourself. You can't take my word for it. Nobody's word for it. You have to prove it to yourself. So that's one very important reason why I said, at the Olympics, you have to prove it to yourself that you're not gonna feel like you've been deprived. And of course, the other reasons are that it was a way to clue everybody into how they're supposed to act for this new reality, supposed new reality. It was like a template, a big template. I mean, more people watched that. It was the most watched event in the history of this planet. And it was a template. This template to say, hey, this is how you need to think, be, act, align yourself with all the ritual, the advertisements, the commercialism, the attitudes, everything. It was all this big song and dance, showing, giving us a template of how we should what we should align with if we, in order to make a transition into this new reality that's supposedly coming. So that's why so many people tuned in. They felt this is very important, and I said, don't tune in, because there's no relevance whatsoever. Complete waste your time. There is no new reality, and all these templates you're being given are nonsense. That's not the template you need. It is the template of spending time in satsang, in consideration of truth. Some big truck coming here. What is this? Ah, UPS truck. Noisy. Okay. The template you need is satsang. So that's why I gave so many satsangs during the Olympics, to give you the opportunity to have that sort of template. And if you make use of it, you realize, wow, I really will, one day I will be able to see for myself that this threat was an empty threat. This threat that's been bedeviling me for so long is an empty threat. And that'll be a great day, great day. And not that it, I'm getting to this point. It's not like I'm head over heels or anything. It's just saying, yeah, come on, that's great. Let's keep it going. Let's keep it going. So again, spending time looking at these templates that are being, have been manufactured by the, endlessly, how to align yourself for the new, to transition the new reality. That's a waste of time. There won't be any new reality. And what you're doing is you're really just simply aligning yourself with avoiding satsang, avoiding consideration, avoiding looking, discovering the origin of this threat. Where's this feeling of being threatened come from, and realizing it's all a bluff. You're lining yourself away from that, which means that feeling of threat will continue deep within you and pester you and keep you feeling uneasy. As long as you don't take a spiritual path, you will be bedeviled in so many ways, and you'll continue to suffer loss and loss and loss and loss, and your suffering goes on and on and on. So really bad to spend time looking at these templates. Why do you think this whole entertainment industry has arisen during these times? The whole Hollywood complex, and television, movies, music, everything, entertainment, empire. Why did it arise now? Because people are desperate for templates to align with, to transition into the new reality. They're desperate. They say, this is what we need. We need templates. And so, right on cue, we, have made all these templates. And like I said, I stopped paying any attention to those templates long ago. Just say, okay, that's enough. I see what they're doing, and it's not going to help me at all. So it's going to hurt me severely. So just no more attention to these templates. And if you do that, you're ahead of the game, but you still need satsang. You still need somehow, some way to have something which is really pointing very strongly towards, what you need to do. You need it. It's helpful. I haven't done it on my own. The effort, I had my own effort, but I also had examples and things I could always say, am I like Ananda Mayama yet? No. I said, well, then I've got to keep going. I'm not there at all. Do I have the clarity that A Course in Miracles speaks about? No, I don't have that perfect clarity yet, so I got to keep going. Am I like Ramana Maharshi? I can just lie down and let this life go, boom. No, there's still this feeling of threat, slight feeling of threat. So you know that you haven't made it yet, and then you're still coming up short, and therefore you know you have to keep working really hard at it. It's like that, and get then some reassurance. It's like, hey, you can do it, it's doable. And that helps. So attending satsang is super helpful, super important. Otherwise, you may spend your time templating towards the quote-unquote new reality, which will never take place. So you're wasting your time making things more difficult, because then satsang will feel like really uncomfortable. All these people are saying, I don't want any situation where I feel uncomfortable. So everybody has to arrange their lives so, my life feels comfortable. The princess and the pea type of thing. Because all these princesses, the princess and the pea thing was where this princess, she lay down on a really nice mattress, and she said, oh, there's a pea underneath the mattress. I feel so terrible. So everyone, scared, we've got to please the princess. So they put another mattress, and she lay down. Oh, the pea's still there. They put another mattress. Oh, I still feel the pea. And then they just kept building up, endless mattresses, and the princess kept saying, I feel so uncomfortable. The pea is still there. I'm not comfortable yet. And oh my gosh, everybody's saying, oh my gosh, we don't want the princess to be unhappy. We have to put another mattress up there. And it came more, the stack of mattresses were very high, so it became very difficult to put the mattresses up there. It became a terrible situation. And they said, well, we don't want the stack of mattresses to fall, and it became a nightmare. We're like that. we're like that. This culture is so worried about pleasing the princess, you know, the one who say, oh, I'm so uncomfortable here. You must do something to make me feel more comfortable. And we think, oh, the princess knows how to get into the new reality. In fact, she's the one who's most aligned with it. So if we please her, we know we'll be able to transit into the new reality. Yeah, that's what we're doing. And then, of course, we get the gurus who come in and say, I know all about the princess. I'm working for the princess, as a matter of fact. And I know exactly what you need to do. So if you please me, they will be automatically align you with the princess who really knows how to get into the new reality. And so then they gobble up all the energy of everybody and live an indulgent lifestyle, you know. And it's a nice little scam for them. As if they're speaking for this princess. So it's better to directly look at this princess who's complaining, say, I'm not comfortable. Everything freaks her out. The princess is easily freaked out. You know, someone said what? That completely freaks me out. You got to change all of society. It needs to be changed, you know, because otherwise that I'll continue to be freaked out and I won't share with you the secrets of how to align and transition in this new reality. As everybody's totally threatened. They're totally scared. And they say, okay, princess, whatever you want, we'll do. Just tell us what to do. She said, well, I want you to, you know, change all these laws, change everything. And she said, okay, we'll do it. And we're all running around desperately trying to change everything, you know. Desperate. And we get these people who are saying that they're aligned with the princess and they know what she really wants. So listen to them and they'll tell you how to go. And of course they're just living it up that way. Now, of course, UPS. Speeding. Come on, UPS, you're going like 10, way too fast there. I had the great fortune of having a guru, Anandamayi Ma, and then I could compare all these princesses with her. I said, wait a minute, you know, she's not complaining about anything. She never complained. They asked her, have you ever been uncomfortable for even a moment in this world? And she said, no. I've never suffered the slightest bit of discomfort. I've never had the slightest feeling of dissatisfaction. I have never been inconvenienced in the slightest bit. She says, how can I be? I'm everywhere. I'm simply reposing within myself. And so she's never bothered by anything. So she's the opposite of the princess. And so, sounds like the UPS again. Oh, gosh. As I said, wait a minute, you know. Here's an example of someone who's aligned with reality saying, no, nothing inconveniences reality. There isn't going to be any new reality. Reality is never not inconvenienced by anything that you may think. So I said, wait a minute, you know, what are these princesses up to, really? They're saying they're so uncomfortable and you need to make sure that they're comfortable and that they're bothered by this and they're bothered by that and throwing up all these fits and tantrums and stuff and we're living in terror, you know, of the play of Shakti and we think we need to please it because if we don't we'll be excluded and that they know the way, you know. In other words, they're like teachers who are letting us know what the new reality wants us to be like, and they say, oh, you can't do that there, or you can't say that there, or you know, oh, you know, you can't look like that. You can't think that way. You can't act that way. You've got to, you know. And of course, it's all a scam. We ceaselessly end up trying to please the princesses, and stacking those mattresses higher and higher and higher. And we ignore satsang. We don't spend our time in the right way, and then the threat is, we still feel this threat. We're going to be excluded. And then we still feel, oh, I got to find some princess to help me not be excluded. Because what I mean by princess is one who's so sensitive, so delicate, so easily bruised and hurt, you know. And that she can tell us, that type can tell us, explain to us, what we did that was wrong, that the idea that the new reality is going to be a very delicate thing, very fragile thing, and you have to treat it with utmost consideration because it's new, it's a baby. The idea is we're going to give birth to this new reality. It's our baby, and our baby's so fragile, and we got to make sure we don't do anything that might harm this baby, you know. And so we look to the mother, the princess mother complex, in other words, who can tell us how do we need to be around this new baby, our new baby. And so as we get closer to the notion that we're going to succeed with this new creation, we end up kowtowing, you know, in abject fear to this mother, princess mother complex, which is what the world is doing. Everybody is just crumbling, you know. If the princess mother says anything, you know, shakes her fist, you know, everybody just like crumbles down into jello. It's so incredible, isn't it, what's going on? Yeah. All it takes is one princess mother complex to stand up there and yell and say, this is what you just did is going to upset my baby or our baby, you know. And everybody just says, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. What do I need to do to repent, you know, from that? And they just collapse in abject fear, you know. But the thing is, there isn't going to be any new baby. There is no new baby. We're not going to give birth to a new reality. We don't need to be treading on eggshells and trying to satisfy these princess mothers, you know, who let us know how we've, you know, erred, you know, who are ironing out all our uncouthness or ironing out anything that might upset this baby, you know. And what they're really doing is they're telling us, whatever you do, don't look directly at the problem. Avoid satsang at all costs. And pay attention to all this fluff and tinsel and glamour and all this kind of stuff. And you'll be okay. You know, they're saying, they're leading you astray. The princess mother complex is leading you astray. Very much astray. And I saw that from the get-go. You know, I said, uh-oh, here it comes. Here it comes. Here comes the princess. Here comes the mother, princess mother complex. Here it comes, skating into the world, you know. And it did, full on tsunami. And now it's completely entrenched in this collective consciousness of this planet. It is completely entrenched. Whereas, you know, all it takes is this complex to shout somewhere, you know. Ah! And everybody go, how can we, you know, what do we do wrong? What do you want us to do? and we'll do anything. Just tell us, you know, tell us how can we calm you down? She goes, you're threatening my child to be. What you said, I know it's going to harm my child to be, you know. And say, oh gosh, okay, sorry. And we live in this terrible, terrible fear right now. It is a nightmare right now. Because the world's dominated by this princess mother complex. And everybody is just crumbling, you know, almost everybody. And you can tell who's done the work and who hasn't. You can tell who's really looked within and who hasn't. Who's really looked at the problem, who hasn't. If you've really looked at the problem, you're not going to crumble, you know. I mean, I still, of course, there's a feeling of discomfort. Like, you know, hey, it's not such a great situation here in the world. But as far as crumbling, you know, into abject terror, no, I'm not. Obviously, I wouldn't be saying this stuff. And there are some in the world who are saying, no. You know, the reality, there's only one reality. And it's perfectly unaffected by anything, cannot be inconvenienced, harmed in any way. And we're free there. And this whole notion that we're supposed to be abject slaves of this princess mother complex here, who supposedly knows how we're supposed to behave towards this new creation that's going to be this new baby, so fragile. And we need to take advice from them, and they are now the experts, the world experts of all things. And that we need to align with their expertise. You know, it's his mother knows best at this time, totally. And the princess is always right time, right now. And everyone's eager, you know, eager to find out from the mother-princess complex, you know, hey, how can we be better parents of this new new creation. You know, what can we do? Just tell us, just tell us. And of course, there are plenty of advice being doled out. Of course, none of it has anything to do with real satsang, what we need, what you, the effort to really look at what the problem is, the scheme, just to see the scheme as it is. Not as we think it might be, as it is. When you see the scheme as it is, you say, ah, okay, I see it. Yeah, it's as simple as that. You say, ah, I was trying to build up this power. We were trying to build up this power. Spirit, saying I, meaning all of spirit. We were trying to build up this power of destructivity so we could threaten God with the destruction of reality, so it would force God to change reality a little bit, thinking that this is such a great deal for God. All reality remained the same, except a little bit change, except by changing endlessness. How can you change endlessness even a little bit except to bring it to an end, which would really mean reality be brought to an end, and then we believe we're going to be able to create a new creation. This is all a scheme that we've been working on, all of this, and it's just a simple, one simple scheme, and it doesn't work, and reality isn't threatened by loss of any kind. Game over. That's just like that. Game over. You know, the scheme over. Not even a game, a scheme over. It's over. You're not afraid. You say, God, this is what I've done. I finally saw it. And you know what God, Prime Creator, will say? Wonderful. I've been waiting for you to see it. This fantastic, you know. The tale of the prodigal returning. You know, and the celebration is tremendous. You know, that story, allegory, or whatever, parable of the prodigal. And Prime Creator, you know, says it is terrific. You finally saw. You saw exactly what it is, just as your simple little scheme. And that's it. You done it. You did it. Scheme over. And, you know, welcome back. We'll give you a rehabilitation period, a reflection of reality. First, let you get used to it, and then you'll easily be able to transition then into the fullness of experiencing, direct experiencing of essence in reality, the freedom, perfect freedom, and unbelievably delightful. We have no, our imagination cannot imagine it, really cannot. I experienced it for a brief time, and I realized, there's no way I'm going to be able to imagine this when I, you know, fall back into fear. No way. There's just no way. Yeah, it's not possible. It's not possible. All our artwork, everything like that, forget it. Don't spend time in artwork. Spend time in satsang. Literally. You can never approximate it. You can never externalize it. You can't imagine it. You cannot do it. Forget it. It's a waste of time. Artwork's a waste of time. Culture is a waste of time. Satsang is not a waste of time. The culture should be a culture of satsang. That's the culture. Forget about all, everything else is a waste. You cannot approximate it. And you don't need to, because there's already a perfect reflection of reality that won't bother us. We won't feel like we're over our heads. We don't. It's easy to work up to that point, but you don't need to spend your time trying to be some great artist or artiste or whatever. Forget it. Do satsang. That's what works. That's what works. And you know, of course, if you're a creative type, it's not easy. I was a very creative type, and I tried to do both, and it got me in some trouble. And I've you know, more and more, I just dropped it all. Forget it. Forget the creativity of it to a large extent. Really, focus on the satsang. Focus on it. You won't regret it. You will not regret doing that. You'll look back and you'll say it's the best movie ever made, because you realize, I did the right thing. I used my time in the right way. And now the threat is gone, because I see it's baseless, it's causeless. And you realize that, you'll say, you are going to be, now you are free of it forever. You are literally liberated from that feeling of threat forever. And of course, the whole scheme, liberated from the whole scheme, the entirety of it. No more loss, no more suffering, no more threat, no more dying, no more sickness, all of that. You're liberated from all of it. And so you realize, hey, All I did was forego maybe writing a few songs, painting a few paintings, dancing a few dances, making a few sculptures, doing a few plays, writing a few books, traveling here, traveling there, building some nice house or whatever you do. You know, you say, all I did was I foregoed those things just for a little while, and in its place, I'm freed of the entire scheme. And you say, wow, I used my time fabulously well. Fabulously well. So no regrets on that. I never know what I'm going to say when I start talking. And I only continue talking because I like what I'm hearing. You know, it's good. It's good. You learn through teaching is how you learn. If you want to really accelerate, you start teaching, realizing that you are the one who's learning through the teaching. That is a fact. Because how can you share with others what you don't have yourself? So the more you want to help others and share with others, the more you have to discover, more clarity you have to discover within yourself. And it puts you on a wonderful intensity of necessity. When I make a video, I have to come up with more clarity. Better, you know, it has to be better than the last video. Constantly has to be better, has to be better. And so then I have to dig deep and be courageous and really get the job done. And then that ends up, you know, shedding all, jettisoning everything that gets in the way of that. And as you do that, you keep jettisoning more and more and more. Like that. Just don't set yourself up, you know, as, you know, the guru. Okay, don't do that, because then that's when the troubles come about for you. You simply share whatever clarity you have with the world, and you know, being aware that you haven't yet reached full perfect clarity, and just admit that to the world. You don't need to say you're something you're not. And I've said all along, I have not reached full clarity. I'm not yet liberated from the feeling of threat from the whole scheme. I'm getting closer and closer and closer for sure. Very aware of that. But no, I haven't done it yet. So I can't claim any, you know, true status, you know, or I'm sharing a lot of clarity. That is true. But I can't say, no, I've reached the end. I've done it. I'm liberated. And I cannot claim that status at all at this point. If and when I'm able to, again, banish the entire, drop the whole scheme, that'll be a different story. That'll be a different story. But you can teach. You can teach and therefore learn. Your whole learning will become vastly accelerated if you do try some teaching. Without trying to claim, you know, don't make any untrue claims about yourself. Because what the problem is, what people will do is they will want you to show them how to, what they need to do to avoid looking at what the problem is. And if you're really desirous of being seen in the world as a teacher, you'll easily get pulled into their demands of those who come to you, and you'll end up being a false teacher. Easily. Happens to so many. That's why I don't see anybody. I have no desire to see anybody at this point. Why? How can? I mean, I can't guarantee I would not be pulled into their, you know, people's demands, like show us how to make a smoother transition into the new reality, which is what they're asking. How do I avoid looking? How do I avoid being excluded from the new reality? That's what they want. And so you end up giving them what you think they want. So they end up supporting you and looking up to you as if you're some kind of teacher. Right, like more than you really are. And it's a very subtle thing, a very vicious thing that leads people who might seem to be very promising teachers, all people start coming to them, and they end up, you know, just throwing out compromised stuff. Yeah, that's what happens. So for me, I say, no, let me just do these videos like Hish, share with whoever wants to. If people don't want it, fine, it's okay. And if and when, you know, I should be able, if and when the entire complex is dropped, then we'll see what happens at that point, you know. still people will come with the same motives, but I may just be able at that point to deal with it somehow. But right now, I don't think I can deal with it. I'm aware it's very tricky. It's very tricky. It's tripped up many. It really has tripped up many. And so don't be in such a hurry to be seen as a big wheel, a big wheel teacher, big hat teacher. Just be content to be a little middling sharer of some clarity, you know, in some way. You know, even if nobody pays attention, I've written so many essays, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of essays. I've now made, you know, my gosh, how many videos, with many are not on the web. I made like 300, over 300 videos, and nobody watched them. So eventually I took them down off the web. But the fact was, I did them in the spirit of sharing, and I learned tremendously from those doing that. Tremendously. The fact that maybe no one else paid attention is secondary. It doesn't matter. At least I made the effort. And same with the essays. I made all these essays, and I realized nobody's interested. I tried posting them and stuff. Nobody read them. I've had many websites, and nobody paid any attention. But I made the effort. And so I learned from all of that more and more and more and more. So you don't have to, in other words, go out in the marketplace and push everything on people. You can simply do it in the spirit of sharing clarity with others and make it available in some way. If no one pays attention, that's okay. Because you will find out that you have dug deeper. By making the effort, you will have accelerated your progress dramatically, dramatically. And so one day you'll end up with both a big hat and a lot of cattle, okay? Which is the goal. Absolutely, it's the goal. Big hat is okay. You just have to have the cattle too, right? You got to have both. I mean, Ananda, my mom, was a big wheel. And, you know, millions and millions and millions of people came to her over her lifetime, you know, and she was very celebrated. But she had all the cattle too, you see. It was a total package. And that's what you need in this world. You have to have the total package, or you don't have anything, really. You really have to have no doubt, or else you're going to teach a mixed message. Guaranteed. Guaranteed you will teach a mixed message. If you're put under pressure. Right now, I'm not under very much pressure. But if you're put under the pressure of the world, then, you know, if you have any doubt, you're going to teach a mixed message. And, you know, you won't be able to walk the walk. You can talk the talk, won't be able to walk the walk. So many talk the talk, and walking the walk, oh boy, they just fall on their faces, you know. And it's tough here, it is really tough. So, again, see if you can remember about this teaching. Try to teach, in some little way. Okay, someone's calling me. That's it for this recording, very great.